was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. And sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed. Broke my chains, freed my soul, and for the first time I had hope.
Let's tell him thank you, church.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light.
Amen. Now you know it. Sing along. Sing it out, church. Tell him.
You took my place, laid aside the tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. Now death has no sting, and life has no end.
Glory to you. Let's pray. How's that? Would you bow with me? Father, as we worship you through song and praise, Father, to get a glimpse of really, from the foundation of the world, you chose that your Son would die on a cross for our sins. That doesn't happen, Lord, we are lost forever. That Jesus would shed his blood on a cross for our sins so that we could have right standing with the holy God. We should be humbled. We should be gracious. And Father, I pray today that you would open our hearts to, Father, choose life today. You've done so much for us. Father, help us to be obedient, to follow you, and to love you, and to serve you, and to be champions for you. Thank you again for the blood of Christ. And thank you for this opportunity today to praise you and just say thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Take your Bible, please, and turn to Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1. And it is an honor, again, I'll say this, to have our graduates here, to have your families here with us and celebrate with you. I want to talk to you this morning on this subject, standing firm in a shifting society. How do we stand in the midst of all the craziness that's going on? I mean, we could talk all morning about all the things that's happened in the last several years in our nation. You know, and nowhere do you get more amens than when you start talking about the nation and what's wrong with the nation. Everybody wants to say, amen, 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 amen. It's all wrong. It's all terrible. It's all bad. But you realize things have been the same all the time. It's nothing new under the sun. Nothing's different. It's wrapped in a different package, but it's all the same. And I want to talk to you today about choices and decisions to make. Choices are important in our life, and the choices and decisions, we make them every day of our life. But the question is this: how do you make choices? What is your foundation? What is your basis for making choices today? Our choices, we find, not only affect our lives, they affect our children. As you get older, they affect your children. They affect your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. Did you know that? The choices you make in life will affect generations to come. Ungodly decisions that you make as a young person, as you get older, and as an older person have eternal consequences and generational consequences as well. Every day, we face all kinds of choices and, you know, what we will eat, what we will wear, where we will go, at school, what you're going to do, and at the job, how you're going to live your life, what are you going to do, make choices at work, choices all around us. Everywhere we go, we make choices each and every day. Nowadays, with emails and texts and phone conversations, I mean, it's all every day making choices. Someone said that we have three basic decisions every day: challenges, choices, and consequences. Challenges, choices, and consequences. Every day of your life, you will face a challenge. Every day of your life, you will have to make a choice on something. Every day of your life, there will be consequences to those choices in our life. Those challenges may come as opportunities or testings or temptations, but God will give us direction. God gives us guidance. And the question is, will we follow God's guidance? That's a basic rule today in our life as a Christian, to say, will I follow the Lord or will I follow the world? God will show us. Someone has said this: we make our choices and our choices will eventually make us. They'll make us. I was reading, before we get into Daniel, we'll get in there in just a moment, but before, I was reading and studying for this text, and I thought, you know, I found this passage in Deuteronomy. So Danny, if you don't mind, put it up there, Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 11. Moses is checking out. He's getting ready to leave this world. And so he's leaving a word from God to the people. And he says this. Listen to what he says in Deuteronomy 30, verse 11. He says, "For this commandment which I command you today," I love this, "is not too mysterious for you." I love that. "Nor is it far off." So he says this, it's not where you can't understand it. Every once in a while somebody says, "Well, I just don't know what God wants. He just needs to tell me. It's too mysterious." God says, "This is not rocket science. This is not too mysterious for you. This is easy. And you're just not very far off too. You don't have to go looking for it." Isn't that great? That's good to know, isn't it? I want to know what God wants. "It's not in heaven that you should say, 'Who will ascend into heaven and bring it to us, that we may hear and do it?'" In other words, he said, "Well, if somebody would just come down and give me a word from heaven, then I would obey it." He said, "You don't have to worry about that. That's something you got to worry about." Verse 13, "Nor is it beyond the sea that you should say, 'Who will go over the sea for us to bring it to us, that we may hear it and do it?'" In other words, if somebody would just go get it, the truth, give me some direction, give me some understanding, then I would do it. There's a lot of that going on today in all of our lives. But he says this in verse 14, "But the word is very near you, in your mouth and in your," what? "In your heart." Why? "That you may do it," he says. Verse 15, "See, I have set before you today," watch this, "life and good, death and evil." God says, "I'm setting some things before you. Two choices for you. Here it is, life and good or death and evil." Well, you would think that would be a pretty easy statement to follow, don't you? God says, "Ron, life and good, death and evil. Which one you want?" I'm going to go, "Sign me up for life and good." Easy. Verse 16, "And that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go to possess." That's the life and good. That's the good choice. That's the good choice. But he says in verse 17, but, transitional, watch this. "But," here's the death and evil, "but if your heart turns away so that you do not hear, and you are drawn away and worship," watch, "other gods," and here it is, "and serve them, I announce to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to go in and possess. Verse 19, I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you that I have set before you," here it is again, "life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose" what? "Life." No brainer, right? Choose life. God says, I've said these, life and death, blessing and cursing. Which one you want? Choose life, he says. He doesn't give it up to you to even think, you know, what do I want to do? He says, choose life. And he says, why is that? And he gives you the answer. Here it is. "That both you and your descendants may live." Watch. The choice to follow God will affect you and affect your descendants behind you. Every once in a while somebody tell me, they say, "Pastor, you know, truthfully, I'm involved in this sin and that sin, but you know, it don't bother anybody but me." Oh, no. Oh, no. God says, no, it bothers. It bothers everybody around you. Generations to come. Choose life, that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, and that you may obey his voice, that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, and that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give. Again, the choice is clear. But he says, make a choice, life and death, or death. Which one? Evil, blessing, cursing, which one you want? And we are to make that choice. And again, verse 15, "See that I've set before you," first choice, life and good, second choice, death and evil. And if you choose right, you choose the choice that God gives you. And he says, I'm telling you what to choose. You choose it, he'll bless you. Again, I'll say this, it's not rocket science. Choose to love the Lord, walk in his ways, obey his voice, or walk in the ways of the world. And when you walk in the ways of the world, you'll live a life of destruction. That's a no-brainer for us today. But watch this, why is that so hard? Why is it so hard? The same reason it was hard back then. They got sucked away by the world. They got sucked away with the worship and the serving of other things and other gods. They did it on a regular basis. Watch. So do people today. You come to church every Sunday and get sucked away by the world. You can put on a good look at church, but be living in a way that leads down to death and cursing. So again, I think that, again, as we look at choices, I think about these graduates and I think about them. But not only do I think about them today, I think about all of us in this room. Every once in a while, we'll hear a sermon and just to graduates. This is just to graduates, but this is to everybody. Because we all choose, we all make choices each and every day of our life. Follow the Lord, follow the world. In this country, listen to me, we're living in a world that has no idea about God. And can I just tell you whose fault that is? That's our fault. We'll be telling people about Jesus. We'll be telling people how to worship God, showing them in our life. But we get so distracted with the world ourselves. We choose not many times to follow. In an anti-God world, how in the world do Christians follow the world? It's very easy. We get sucked away. The truth is, we have trouble with every basic decisions of life. Do you know most people can't manage their time very well? You ever do a time study management in your own life? You want to be careful. Most people don't know how to manage their time. Most people don't know how to eat right. Amen? I saw a t-shirt the other day that said this: a year from now, you'll wish you've started today. That's exactly right. And that happens in a lot of areas of our life. I'm going to serve the Lord. You said that a year ago. What's happened? See, now I wish I started a year. Let me see how that works. Choices that we make. A lot of decisions are made when people are young. People follow Christ at an early age. Many people do. Again, they come to Christ as a child or a young teen or in their 20s. You often pick out who you're going to marry at early in age, in ages like that, to say, you know, this is, I'm dating, and all of a sudden I get married. And most people in this room, again, barring some kind of situation in your life, you know, your spouse is the one you had when you were early in life. Most of the time you pick your friends on a regular basis pretty quick, don't we? Hey, can I tell you what God says about picking your friends? And this is not just for young people, but it is for young people, but it's not just for young people, okay? Because all of us, if you don't have a friend, raise your hand. Let me see. You do not have a friend. We'll get you one today, but you just don't. J.R. Turner, the only one to raise his hand. Listen to what the Bible says about your friends. Proverbs 13, verse 20. He who walks with wise men will be wise, but the companion of fools will be destroyed. Well, that's a pretty clear statement, isn't it? Walk with wise people, you'll be blessed. Walk with a foolish person, you won't. Wise people, the beginning of wisdom, fear the Lord, right? Know the Lord. You walk with people who walk with God, you'll be blessed. You walk with people, the Bible says, a fool has said in his heart, there is no God. You walk with people who are ungodly, your life will be a life of destruction. Watch, it's all through the Bible. It's the same principle. We choose God or we choose the world. We choose Christ or we choose the enemy to live for and to serve with. As you get older, a lot of decisions of your life revolve around your job, your career, don't they? Where you live, what you're going to do, how you're going to go along in life. A better job, a better house, a better home. Well, all those things, you know, you just get distracted and make choices based around that. And as you get older, sometimes health is an issue. People make health decisions based on what's going on in their life. Another proverb, you say you're going to get Daniel maybe in a minute. Listen, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 1. Listen to this passage. Whoever loves instruction loves knowledge. That's pretty easy, isn't it? Whoever you love that, you love instruction, you love knowledge. But listen to this, but he who hates correction is stupid. Some little kids out there going, oh, he said a bad word. Yeah, but he's stupid, the Bible says. You say, what does that mean? King James says brutish. You say, oh, what does that mean? What it means is this, the word means senseless or dull-minded like an animal. The verb form of the root word there, the form is the word beast. And the tendency of that word is to, as you study a little bit, it says this, it's sort of a contrast between a man's ability to reason and an animal's ability not to reason. So what he's saying is this, whoever loves instruction loves knowledge, but whoever hates correction is dumb like an animal. So what does that mean? I make right choices based in life, based on truth, based on instruction. Life's full of decisions. We need the wisdom of God to lead us. Now let's get to Daniel. All right. Daniel chapter 1. Let's go skip down to verse 8. Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8. Listen to what the Bible says. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now, just a quick background here. Daniel has been taken captivity. He's been taken by the Babylonians. They've taken a lot of the sharp young men in. And what they're going to do is they're going to train them for a few years the ways of the Babylonians. They're looking at them. They want the good-looking guys. They want the ones that are smart and intelligent. They want the ones that they can really hone in and sharpen and brainwash to make them Babylonians. They want to take their wisdom, their culture, their ideas, and change them into Babylonians. So now Daniel is far away from home. He's there with a bunch of guys. Several deportations to the Jews in Babylon before the fall of Jerusalem. Many believe that Daniel, this time was about 605 B.C., and that Daniel was probably 15 or 16 years old. So now Daniel's in a foreign country, a wicked empire, ungodly things going on all around him. He's 15, he's 16 years old. He's there with a bunch of other guys that have been taken captive. And now he's going to sit down at the king's table, and they're going to say, look, guys, this is what we want you to eat. This is what we want you to drink. This is how we want you to behave. We're going to teach you a whole new culture and everything. You're away from home, it doesn't matter. Your life is here now. You're in the Babylonian Empire. They changed their name. They changed everything about them, their culture and everything in a moment's period of time. Can you imagine being taken out of your culture and setting and taken over into a foreign country and a wicked, evil empire? And they're going to tell you how to live and tell you what to do. I think our head would blow up. We don't know how that would be in a world that we live in today. We're so used to doing what we want, how we want it, when we want it. No one telling us what to do. We're Americans, right? Well, then here's Daniel. He's taken, his whole life has changed. Now he's sitting before the king, and now he's got to make a choice. He's got to make a choice, and here's verse 8 again. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself. And you say, with what? Here it is. With the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Daniel made a decision, a choice, early in his life, very young teen, that he would absolutely not disobey God, listen to me, no matter what. Now, young people, that's important. To start early. As a young person to go, you know what? My faith is not just for old people. My faith is not just for when I get older. I'll be a champion for Christ as a child. I'm going to do what God tells me to do as a child, as a teenager, in my young 20s, in my early time. I'm going to do what God says, no matter what. And listen to me, adults, that'd be a good thing for us to get a hold of as well. That no matter what this world dictates, no matter what comes down the pike, I am going to choose to follow God, be faithful to Him and His Word above and foremost over everything in my life. Anything that comes down the pike, anything that comes toward me, anything that my family, my job, anything that comes along, I choose to follow God no matter what. Amen. That needs to be graduates. But that needs to be elementary school. That needs to be high school, middle school. That needs to be every area of our life. To make a choice, listen, to follow God. No matter what. So how'd Daniel do it? A couple things real quick. First thing I want you to notice about Daniel is this. He made a decision of the heart. Verse 8 says this, but Daniel purposed in his heart. That word purpose there means to set in place or to appoint or to choose. He chose and said, this is what I'm going to do. Based on what? Based on his heart. What was his heart based on? The word of God. Following God. You say, he's pretty young. Yeah, he's 15. He's a champion. He's a champion for God at 15. And I'll tell you this, he lived on and on and on many years, but that man was a champion from day one. And he did great things for God, and God blessed him in a powerful, powerful way. The word heart there means his inner man. According to the Bible, the heart is the center not only of our spiritual activity, but also the operations of our life. Basically, the core of your being. When someone says, I've trusted Jesus Christ with all my heart, what they're saying is, every core of my being, every ounce of who I am, I've trusted Christ. Somebody says, well, she just put her whole heart into that. What they're saying is, she put all of herself in that. There's nothing left behind. They love each other with all their heart. They're sold out completely to each other. Daniel says, I purposed, I've appointed, I've chosen, I made a decision in my core not to defile myself, to do what God asked me to do no matter what in my life. I don't care what age you are today, have you purposed in your heart to take that stand? That no matter what they say at work, I'm going to follow Christ. No matter what they say at school, I'm going to follow Jesus. No matter all the ridicule and rant that I get for being a Christian, I'm going to stand for Christ. Every decision is a decision of the heart, really, isn't it? Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 says this, keep your heart with all diligence. Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. They could change Daniel's home. They could change his diet. They could change his name, but they could not change his heart. And listen to me, if you purpose in your heart, nobody can change it. They may change your job. They may change a lot around you, but they cannot change your heart. Now, you give them opportunity. You follow the world. You let the world squeeze you out of the mold of Christ, and you start living for the enemy. You start living for the world. You'll see your heart change and bend toward the world. But no one can make you. No one can make you not purpose your heart toward God. It was a personal decision. Verse 8, Daniel purposed in his heart. This was the decision he made between him and the Lord. He purposed between him and the Lord. It wasn't an easy decision. We're going to see Daniel had a lot of pressure, a lot of pressure. He's away from his family. Can you imagine? Sometimes we go to college, you get away from your family. I've seen people go to college, get away from their family, and just live like the devil. No restraints here. Live like I want. Just do what I want. Act like I want. Mom and Dad's not here to watch me. Yeah, no guardrails. No restraints. But Daniel is far away from his homeland in a culture that was anti-God, but not only anti-God, it was perverted. And here's a 15, 16-year-old young man. He says, I will stand for God. It was a personal choice that he made. Young people today, you're going to be in a lot of pressure to deal with the things of this world. You're going to deal with some things because this world is anti-God and anti-Christ. And there's a lot of things they're trying to put down our throats and say is normal. That's not normal. Right. See, how do you know? Because I still have my Bible. Right. Still have my Bible to tell me what's right and what's wrong. Yeah. I don't need a government. I don't need a president. I don't need a society. I don't need a culture telling me what's right and wrong. I've got the word of truth that's right here. Yeah. And I can take a stand based on what God says. Yeah. And no matter what they throw down the pike, I can still stand. We can still stand and say, this is what God says. This is how I will stand. And this is where I will go forward. But it doesn't mean there's not pressure with that. There's a lot of pressure in that. You care about what God says? Yes. If you care about what God says, say amen.
Amen.
Ah, that's so good. So good. But let me ask you, let me go a little further with that, all right? Here's a little bit more detail. Do you care what God says about your friends? Do you care what God says about your family?
Yeah.
Do you care what God says about immorality?
Yeah.
Do you care what God says about honesty?
Amen.
Do you care what God says about integrity?
Yeah.
Are we living those things out? Well, I compromise my friends a little bit. I compromise my family a little bit. You know, I don't prioritize the things of God that much. Immorality, well, you know, two people love each other, you know, it's one of those things. Honesty, well, you know, most of the time I'm honest unless it's something's going to cost me money. Integrity. Where do you get your standards from? That's a question. We don't get them from the world, but where do you get them? Where do we get our standards from? Daniel didn't go along with the pressure to be conformed to this world. But he stood and was transformed by God. But listen, folks, we can say amen, and we can say yes, 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 but really when the rubber hits the road in our everyday life and choices and decisions, are we standing for God or not? That's a real question. That's a question every one of us has to answer before the Lord. There's pressure. There's pressure from the world. There's pressure from his friends and his peers. I can just imagine, can't you? Can you see that going on? They're bringing all that stuff in there, and Daniel's like, excuse me. And you probably see these guys around him rolling their eyes going, no, not again, not again, not again. Excuse me, is there anything else? No, that's what you're supposed to eat, King said. King's menu. Yeah, you know, can I talk to somebody about that? You know, and I just see the friends going, come on, dude, just eat it. Just, no one's here to tell on, just eat, drink, what did you, just do what they tell you. It's no big deal, right? You see how the pressure comes in? Sometimes it does that in the world here, doesn't it? Come on, dude, just do it. Just be a part of us. Just do what we say. Just do what we do. Come on, Daniel, nobody's here now. You're not at home. Don't be so religious, man. Watch this. Have some fun. Won't hurt you. You think? It's not going to be that big a deal, man. Just keep, no. It's pressure from his friends. The pressure is consequences of decision. Truth is this, you balk the king, you could die. And most did die. We don't have time, and I would not tell you all the things that the Babylonians did to people. It was terrible. And you balk the king, and you could die like that. And they didn't think twice about it. The consequences of his decision not to do this little bitty thing. You say, well, it's just drinking a little bit and just a little bit of food and stuff like that. What's the big deal? I'll tell you the big deal in a moment. But the thing with this is if you balk it in the system, you can die immediately. See, 2 Timothy 3:12 says this, all who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. There are times that you make a decision in life that the consequences won't be what you want. When you stand for Christ, you may not have a good outcome. No, hey, by the way, don't believe the lie out of hell that says everything you do for Christ is going to make your life easier. It won't. It won't. What we've done today is we've watered down repentance and we've watered down what it means to be committed to Christ and say, well, you just live like you want and be faithful. No, you cannot. You've got to take a stand for Christ in every area of our life. And some of those stands, again, some of those stands are just what, but some of them are just, man, you get beat up, get wore out. Sometimes it costs to follow Jesus. Your job, you may not get that job. You may not get to keep that job because you're following Jesus. School, people may reject you. They may call you whatever they call you because you're standing for Christ. You may have some good friends that leave you and don't want to hang around you anymore because you stand for Jesus and you won't go partying with them and doing all the things that they're doing. And folks, you may even have family. Turn their back on you because you follow Christ. It'll cost you. And you might be persecuted for it. But Romans 12:2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Daniel said, I am not going to conform to this world. I'm going to stand for my God. Now there were scriptural reasons. There are a lot of reasons Daniel probably didn't want to eat that, but you know, they could have said, you know, the truth is the Jews didn't prepare their food the way that they were preparing. They had certain restrictions, Leviticus 11, on how they should prepare their food and what they did. So he could have said, well, that's not the way we prepare the food over there. But I don't think that's the reason. I don't think that may be one of the reasons, but I don't think that's the ultimate reason. I think one of the ultimate reasons was this. When you study a little bit about the Babylonian culture, what you're going to find is that when they drank their wine and when they ate their meat and their food and their delicacies, they would do it, listen, in an act of worship to their gods. So they didn't just give you a plate and say, hey, there, go ahead and eat that. No, you could eat it, but as you raise the toast, you toasted to their gods. When you ate the meat, you thanked their God for that meat. And you glorified their gods, their false gods, for all the things that you've been put there in front of you. And that was a part of their culture. That was a part of their ritual and how they ate. And so Daniel steps back and he says, I can't do that. I can't raise a glass to their God. I can't say thank their God for this meat. I know it didn't come from him. False God. I can't do that. Remember, Daniel gets also in trouble later on when they say, okay, bow down to the idol. This big 90-foot idol, when the harps and all the music plays, everyone's going to bow down. Daniel says, I can't do that. I'm sorry. I can't worship any other God. Top commandment. Have no other gods before. I can't do that. I can't make their God a God. Even if I faked it, I can't do it. So Daniel says, I'm sorry. I'm just not going to do it. He took a stand for God no matter what. He made up his mind that what God said was the most important thing in his life. David made that statement in Psalm 119:11, your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. See, every once in a while somebody said, well, I read my Bible. I just get nothing out of it sometimes. Can I just tell you, I'm going to help you with this. Listen, ready? We always say that in staff. I'm going to help you with this. I'm going to help you. You keep reading it. You just keep reading. Well, I didn't get anything out today. Just keep reading it. Keep on, keep on, keep on, keep on. Why is that? Because God, what he's doing, he's building a reservoir in your heart. He knows what's coming down the road. He knows what's coming down the pike. And he knows one day you're going to draw in that well, the word, and you're going to have something there. Keep hiding it in your heart. Keep studying the word of God. Keep reading it each and every day. That's your plan. That's your goal. That's your foundation. And Daniel said, I'm going to stand on that. And by the way, I'm sure he didn't have any Bibles laying around there in Babylonians. As a little kid, he'd been hearing the word. As a little kid, he'd been worshiping his God. As a little kid, he grew up, listen to me, with all that in there, and now all of a sudden he's taking a stand, purposed in his heart to take a stand for his God. One of the things, I don't have time this morning, but one of the things I think is most important is this. One of the things we've got to get back to learning today, I think, in our world and our society is this, is the word no. Just say no. Just say no. Well, I think you ought to do this. No. It's okay to be a champion for Christ. Understand? It's okay to take a stand for Jesus. It's okay to say, I'm going to stand on the word of God, and I'm not going to compromise. That's okay. And a lot of times, you have to say no. Come on, man. Go have a beer with us. Let's go out and have a beer. They got a beer. So-and-so's got some beer. They got some beer at their house. Let's go. No, dude, I'm good. Really? Come on, man. We're going to have a good time. Yeah, I'm good. No. Just a little bit. Man, it's not about it. Just hang out with us. No, I'm sorry. No. Everybody's going to laugh at you. Everybody can make fun of you. Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. Not going to hurt you, bro. Yeah, but no. No thanks. You may lose a lot of friends over this. Yeah, but no. I'm not. Why? Because God's word is the most important thing. God, my commitment in life to him, my purpose, my life and heart to him is more important than my friendship. It's more important than it's more important than my life. So we stand for him by saying no to the world. It happens a lot of times in relationships. Well, if you love me, you'll do this. No, truth is, I love you, so I'm not going to do that. Did you hear me? I love you so much, I'm not going to do that before we're married. That's how much I care. People want to just compromise. I'm just telling you, they want to word it down, water it down, and just say, you know what, if you love me, everybody's doing this, I know, but no, I'm not. Be separate. Be a champion. Be someone with conviction that stands for God. Do what's right. Never wrong to do what's right. You keep saying no, and you'll never be an alcoholic. You keep saying no, and you'll be pure when you get married. So all kinds of things we could go into today, but there's a lot of things you're going to face each and every day of your life. That some choices, some decisions, it's just best to say no, because my Savior doesn't want that for me. He knows what's best for me, and that's not it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Daniel made a heart decision to say no. And it was a powerful decision. I don't have time to get into that. But verse 8, The Bible says Daniel purposed in his heart. But then if you look down at verse 10, and the chief of the eunuchs said to Daniel, I fear my lord the king who has appointed your food and drink, for why should he see your faces looking bad? The guy told him, said, look, if I give you, Daniel said basically, he said, just give us some water and give me some vegetables. Give me some grain, some vegetables, those things. And the guy looked at him and said, why would I do that? Because if I do that and you start looking bad, the king's going to take my head off. Right? But what's interesting about that is this. It starts off with Daniel making a decision, and then now all of a sudden, you got some more guys along with him making decisions. Isn't that good? Which tells me, no matter what age you are, that if I take a stand for Christ, I'm not going to be the Lone Ranger. You might be, but chances are you won't be, because there's other people around you who are just looking for somebody to say, I want to do that too. I want to be a part of standing for what's right. Can we do this together? And you'll see God do a great revival in just a short period of time, just because you stood for him. Daniel starts it off, and now it's spread to others as well. Daniel's decision of the heart. Let me give you this too. Daniel's decision for holiness, verse 8. It goes along with what we just said. Strong convictions, purity, loyalty, and integrity. Let me ask you a question. This is a good question for all of us. Do you sell out your convictions to the highest or the lowest bidder? I say the lowest. It's really the lowest bidder. Do you sell out your... What would it take for you to sell out your honesty? For you not to be honest? Well, there's a little white lie. Not that big a deal. Right? You ever say that? Well, I didn't tell the truth. They didn't ask me the whole thing, so I didn't tell them the whole thing. You know, I'll just leave it out and sort of just imply that it's a lie. Just you yes be yes, you no be no. It's no games, no gymnastics of trying to just go through hoops. Do you sell out your honesty, your integrity, your purity? Verse 8, Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself. He took a stand for his purity. Would to God that we would do that today. You say, yeah, them young people need to be... Stop for a moment. We could talk this morning about pornography, and we could talk about the internet, and we could talk about the phone, and we could talk about all the impure things that are seen and done on phones. You know, it used to be that the pornography industry was sort of limited to back behind the counter books. And if you wanted to go into and get into the pornography issue, you'd have to go in and ask and be on the spot to ask somebody for that kind of magazine or whatever. Not today. Today, is there statistics, I won't give them to you, they'll bore you, but there's statistics about how many people today are involved in pornography on their phones and on their computers. And there are statistics to tell us how many Christians and church members are doing that. There are statistics to tell us how many pastors and staff members are in pornography. So when we talk about being pure, don't look at the young people and just go, you guys need to do this. It's for all people, all believers. Daniel said, I will not defile myself. I will take a stand. He said, I'll take a stand. Well, I love what Daniel did. He goes to the guy and he looks at the eunuch. He says this. He's got a little plan. And he says basically this. He says, could we do a test? Is it okay to do a test? And he does that. And so you say, well, why did he do that? I think Daniel could have said, bless God, I won't do that because my God. And he could have called down all that. He could have done all that. But he did in a very gracious and humble way to say, excuse me, sir. Do you mind if we do a little test? 10 days, give us bread, or give us water and grain and vegetables, give us those things, and then just do a test on us, just for 10 days. And if we don't look better, fine, but if we do, you'll know. And the guy says, well, first he says, nah, it ain't gonna happen. And then he says, okay, 10 days, we'll do it. And he does it. I love it about Daniel. One thing I love about him is this. I've heard the statement. Somebody said, some of the Christians I know, they're right about a lot of things, but they're just mean about it. Somebody said, like a porcupine, got a lot of good points, you just can't get close to them. A lot of people like that. I love what Daniel did. He didn't blast him. He didn't put him down, didn't run him down. He just said, excuse me, sir, this is my conviction. This is my stand. How about, can we try this? And you see what God did. God blessed him. God honored him. And I love it. After those 10 days, the Bible tells us their countenance was, listen, was better than the other guys. They looked stronger. They looked more healthy. You know what God did? God said, hang on, buddy. I'm going to bless your faithfulness. And he did. And he was able to look at their countenance and see, watch this, that they were godly. Just by what they ate and drank. It's a God thing. God did the same for us. The last thing I want you to see is this, for sake of time, God's deliverance of honor. Daniel took a stand for God. And can I tell you this for a moment? He did not know how that would turn out. I don't think he knew. Listen, you go in the lion's den, okay. How's that going to turn out for you? Don't know. Probably not too good. Probably not too good. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We're going to put you in the fiery furnace. How's that going to go? Don't know. Have no idea. But then, remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Here's what they said. Listen, King, we need to tell you this. And we don't mind telling you this. We're quick to tell you this. Our God that we serve is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace. But if he does not, I love that part. But if he does not, we still ain't going to bow down to you. Okay. Gone. And God delivered them. Could God may have not delivered them? He could not have. If he did. There's a lot of people who have been martyred and killed for their faith. That God did not deliver that way. He delivered them into heaven. So Daniel, he didn't know how this is going to turn out. But he took a stand for God. And can I tell you this? Listen to me. You take a stand for Christ. You live for his glory and for his praise. You put no matter what, you make your choices and decisions based on the word of God and where he stands. And I guarantee you, God will bless you one way or the other. It may not turn out the way you want or the way you like, but it'll be the best for our sovereign God. He'll lay it out for you, and he'll do the best for all of us. The Bible tells us, and we can go on. The Bible tells us he honored the men with wisdom. I mean, Daniel was he was influential in that kingdom for years and years and years to come. He was the king's mighty man, the guy that he listened to above all the others. God blessed him because of his stand as a 15, 16-year-old kid. What would have happened had he not stood for God as a 15, 16-year-old? We don't know. But I really don't think that it would have turned out the same way had he just gone along with the crowd. You know, the truth is this. When you see that bunch in the Bible, you don't see anybody's name in that group, but you see Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's the only ones you see. All the rest of them, you don't see them. Why is that? They compromised. Who knows what happened to them? We don't know. Some of them may have followed later on. We don't know. But what we do know is this, that when we follow Christ, when we take a stand for him and choose what he wants for us and what his word says, we will always, 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 did you hear me say, always be blessed because we're doing it his way. You can't lose doing it God's way. Choose this day, Joshua would say, whom you will serve. Whether the gods over there or the one true God. Me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Moses, life or death, blessing or cursing. It's a choice. God says, choose life. I love that part. Choose life. Let me tell you what choose, just in case you're wondering. Choose life. Where are you at today? I love our graduates. Love them. And I'm praying for them. I've been praying for them. Brother Pastor's been praying. We pray for them. That God would use them in a great and powerful way. But today, every one of us in this room are going to make choices. Choices from challenges that serve as consequences. And if I stand for Christ and I stand for the Lord, I'm right every time. How can you be smarter than your teachers? You're smarter than your teachers by standing on the Word of God. You may have a godly teacher. Wonderful. But you might get out in some situations where you've got some influence of people that aren't so godly, and they want to teach you and tell you, All you got to do is turn on TV and you'll see those people. But we still got our Bible. And we stand choosing life because that's what God wants us to do. Would you bow with me? As we come to the conclusion today, I just would encourage you, however the Holy Spirit of God touches your heart with the word, that you make a choice to follow God. You say, I'm a Christian preacher. Great. Are you following Him? Are you choosing daily life? Are you choosing faithfully obedience to His word? Or you got caught up in the world so much that just so everything's so spinning so much that you're just not really sure where you get back. Get back to where you need to be and follow Him. Maybe you're here this morning, you say, you know what, preacher, I'm not a Christian. I don't know anything about all that. I'm just here today to celebrate. The Bible's great and clear to help us understand. We sang it earlier that Jesus died on a cross for our sins. He loved you. He loved me so much that He died on the cross to pay for our sins so that you and I can stand right before a holy God. And in your heart, you say, you know what, preacher? Man, I want that. I want God in my life. I want to be forgiven of my sins. I believe in my heart that Jesus died for me. I really truly believe that, Ron, that He died for me. The Bible says, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Would you call on His name and say, oh God, I believe. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Come into my life. I believe You're the Son of God. I believe You died for me. When God, the Holy Spirit, just grabs your heart, take a stand for Christ. In a moment, you come. Say, Ron, today's the day. I want to let everybody know that I believe in Jesus. Maybe you hear you say, I'm a Christian, but you know what, man? Today's the day. Right where you sit, today's the day that I'm going to turn back and say, you know what, God? I got to quit following the world. I got to get back to You. Forgive me, and I repent. Maybe you need to join this church where God's called you to be, or maybe profess Christ. You need to get baptized, whatever God's laid on your heart. But you, in a moment, whatever God says in your heart, you be obedient. Father, I thank You and I praise You for this opportunity. Father, thank You again for our graduates and their families. Bless them today. And Father, I pray today that You would bless those who are contemplating being saved. Father, those who have believed in You, trusted in You. Father, those who, again, need to get back to You and just say, you know what, I got to quit messing with the world. I got to get back to being obedient. And Father, I just thank You for this privilege today. Bless us as we sing, again, another song of worship to You in Jesus' name.